What's up, everybody? Welcome back to my channel. If you haven't already, make sure to hit that subscribe button so you don't miss out on a single video. The sixth episode of the eighth season of Teen Mom 2 kicked off with David and Jenelle speaking about their new prefab home, and David said that he wanted it to be passed down for 10 generations after them. Okay, and then after that, Briana takes her daughter Nova for a little bit of a silk press, because in the last episode she was talking about wanting to have straight hair, and I guess this was, you know, probably really good for her to get to see what she looks like with straight hair, so I'm all for it. And silk presses are easily reversible and would not damage her natural curls. So after that, she talks with her sister Brittany about looking for a loophole in how they can possibly put up her upcoming daughter Stella for adoption, even if Lewis continues to not want to go along with the plan. Over in Dover, Chris actually FaceTimes Kale while they're filming, and she's with two of her friends, and you can just tell that she was absolutely over the moon ecstatic that her baby daddy actually acknowledged her in public for what is probably the first time ever, and it's just so freaking sad to witness, you guys. Leah complains to her friend about her regular ass 1 hour commute to school and how her pyramid scheme business is taking up lots of time. And of course, taking care of her kids as well is making the whole school thing really difficult for her to keep up with. And I just found them all to be a whole bunch of BS excuses. A 1 hour commute to school is not like unusual or anything like that. I'm pretty sure most people even took public transportation to get to school, while she gets to drive this nice luxury car. Do you know what I mean? And her little pyramid scheme business is one of those like turnkey businesses where you literally just punch people's names in, or they just fill out a form and it all just happens, you know, for you. She's not actually manually fulfilling orders or anything like that. So I don't understand why she was acting like it was a huge thing. And then her other excuse of having to take care of her kids is also pretty much BS in my opinion, because she doesn't even have full custody of the twins, right? Like, Corey has full custody of them while she has part-time. She only gets to see them every weekend or every other weekend or something like that. So no, Leah, I'm not buying what the hell you're selling over here. You are just too either lazy or not sharp enough to really keep up with your college classes, and that's, you know, 90% of your problem in my opinion. Like, literally imagine her actually having a real job on top of all of this. She probably wouldn't have even lasted a week, like many of the teen moms that I know who have done the whole take more than an hour of public transport to get to school while you still have your kid full time and you're also working an actual like job that is minimum wage, trying to make ends meet. Over in Sioux Falls, Aubrey is getting ready to go with Grandma Donna to get her supervised visitation with her father, Adam. And Chelsea talks to a producer about how nervous she is for both Aubrey and Paisley, but mainly Paisley, because she's a lot less protected in terms of her interactions with Adam as of now, because they have a drug addicted father. And she talks about how she feels guilty that this is who Aubrey's father is, because while she was hit with him, he was never on drugs, and it's not something she ever saw for the future. And it's just so sad to see that this is where things have gone with Adam's life. The one scene we got of Barbara and Jace this season was disturbing as all hell, you guys. Literally, Barbara is driving Jace around, and Jace just casually mentions how funny it would be if while they were driving, Barbara was kind of just impaled through the mouth or like whatever via a giant icicle. Yeah. And then in an even crazier scene, Jenelle goes to pick up Marissa in like the big Dodge truck that they have, and there's a huge mess of like all the stuff from the move, like just piled up in the car. You literally can't see through that like rear view mirror or whatever. And so while they're driving, David calls and there's a sound from the back, and I was like, whoa, 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 that sounds like a child. Like, surely there's no child in the back with all of that junk. Like, this stuff literally gives whatever Leah had that one season a run for its money. She actually had Kaiser in the back with all of this stuff where he could have easily like been suffocated by it. Like, imagine they, like, God forbid, got into a crash or an accident or something. What would have happened to him with all that stuff back there, you know? So David is on the phone and Kaiser's really happy and stuff, and so Jenelle hangs up with him. And Kaiser just gets into full-blown meltdown mode. He starts crying and stuff like that. And Jenelle doesn't even, like, for a second try to calm him down or anything. She's just like, oh my God, Kaiser, what the heck? Dude, I'm gonna lose it. I'm gonna lose it. And she calls up David to complain that Kaiser is crying. Like, really? She's like, David, Kaiser's crying because I just got off the phone with you. Say something. And so David's like, Kaiser, like, do you want to have a timeout when you get home? Like, stop it. I'll see you when you get home. And Kaiser's kind of okay until she hangs up again and he starts crying again. And Jenelle, again, instead of trying to do this whole maternal thing, I mean, she tries for all of 5 seconds to repeat what David had just told Kaiser, but she flips out and calls David again. You guys, I swear to God, Jenelle treats this child like she hates him or something. It's so insane. David's like 8, 9, 10-year-old daughter, Marissa, handles Kaiser's meltdown a lot better than Jenelle, like leaps and bounds better. And sadly, that's not surprising at all. Meanwhile, in Florida, Briana visits an adoption counselor to talk about how her stupid ass managed to get into the same damn exact situation twice within the span of like 3 years. And the counselor actually did a pretty good job of trying to not look like she was judging Briana, but you can totally tell she was judging the hell out of her, which I do not blame her for. And so Briana asks her how it would be possible to go through with an adoption even if Lewis was not on board with it. And so the counselor tells her that there is this like 30-day option where they can like send him a letter, and if he does not respond or show that he's been financially or emotionally supportive throughout the pregnancy, they can actually go forward and put the baby up for adoption despite his protests. In a really interesting scene that I feel totally misrepresents the university experience and makes it seem more like a high school experience, Kale goes to visit her counselor and talk about her her pace, whether or not she's on track to graduate at the end of the semester. So the counselor and Kale reveal that Kale had been not turning in assignments, at least 3 or 4, just not showing up to certain classes, and also that she had flunked some sort of a test or something. And then the counselor talks about how she had kind of reached out to one of Kale's professors about how she can make up things that she had either flunked or just didn't turn in. And I was kind of like, I'm pretty sure, like, it's been a while since I was in uni, but I'm don't remember it working that way. I'm pretty sure you're supposed to be an adult and either do your things or fail. There's no hand-holding, and guidance counselors, the last time I checked, did not reach out to your professors for you and try to like weasel your D minuses up to D's or D pluses so that you can graduate. And another thing that this scene got me thinking of was the fact that Kayla has been kind of talking to the press about her thoughts on potentially going to grad school one day, and I kind of feel like after this conversation, it doesn't really sound like that's all that much of a possibility for her, because your grades cannot be like this if you're getting into grad school, last I checked. And then the counselor kind of asks her about the whole pregnancy thing, and Kale says that Chris just comes around when he wants to, and that, you know what, she did bring it all on herself, and that's gotta be like the most truthful thing Petty Betty has said all season. And I'm like, yeah, girl, you really did bring this all on yourself. I wonder whether or not that $10,000 donation she made to the school prior to all of this stuff being filmed has anything to do with why her hand was being held so tightly and like her being dragged over the graduation line. Taylor heads over to Chelsea's house to talk about their custody schedules with Adam and how they both knew about the drug thing for ages, and that they worry about whether or not his parents are actually enabling him. In a crossover between the girls, Leah FaceTimes Kale about school and how she thinks she's neglecting her kids because she goes to school. Like, this girl is really grasping for straws to explain why she's not going to make it down the graduation podium. Like, this is just ridiculous at this point. She then mentions how she wants to switch to online school. Addie then interrupts to tell Kale that she's seen her on Teen Mom, and it was just one of the funniest, cutest little scenes ever. And then Leah gives Kale the same like spiel she gave us about these empty, half-assed excuses as to why she's not doing that great with the whole school thing and why she wants to switch over into online. Let me tell you guys why Jenelle Lauren Evans is the gift that keeps on giving, okay? So she is just at home with all this laundry and she's doing the dishes, and one of the producers is trying to make her feel like super mom or whatever just because she does a few things around her house. And so she complains about how ever since her daughter has been born, and I'm pretty sure Ensley was like, what, 4, 5, 6 weeks at this point, she hasn't been able to go to the gym. So the producer's like, what do you mean? Like, why don't you and David kind of take shifts so that he could watch her while you go to the gym? Jenelle's like, no, because I want to go to the gym with David. And the producer's face for like a solid 5 seconds was literally like, what the fuck? I do not get paid enough for this bullshit, but I'm just going to keep on smiling because I know this girl has the biggest meltdowns of all time. It was priceless, you guys. Kale finishes her assignment, which is some kind of branding video about herself, featuring her Teen Mom reunion clips and books. I don't know why she went as far as calling herself a branding phenom in her presentation when she literally does the same thing every other D-list reality star, including the other teen moms, does to quote unquote brand themselves, which is release a bunch of half-ass memoir books, sell stories to tabloids, and get involved with pyramid schemes like that Sensi stuff she was doing and whatever else, like sell ads on Instagram. Like, you're really not a branding phenom. She actually had the nerve to put herself in the same sentence as Queen Oprah Winfrey. I was like, all right, chick, drag yourself on worldwide TV, why don't you? Meanwhile in Florida, Briana talks to Louis about the adoption visit and reveals the 30-day loophole to him. Louis again tells her that he wants to parent as a couple and that he's attached to the baby, and Briana kind of goes, well, maybe you're attached and I'm not, which was kind of like, really, chick, we all know you are, and this is just some BS storyline thing, but that was a bit too far considering the fact that this is all just for TV. And then to close that scene up, Louis again apologizes for cheating and begs her to take him back, and of course she says, no way, Jose. So while Jenelle and David are driving off somewhere, Jenelle has another like random ass meltdown in front of Marissa, mind you, about the fact that she can't go to the gym anymore since the baby's been born. And so David's like, well, why don't you just go earlier instead of just sitting around in bed staring at your phone all damn day? And the two of them just go at it like cats and dogs, to the point where mid-conversation, David literally just gets out of the truck once they land somewhere and slams the door in her face while she's still yelling, and I got my whole entire life. You can tell fighting in this household is absolutely normal, sadly so. Just by Marissa's reaction, she literally like never really looked up from her iPhone and didn't look uncomfortable at all. And my grown ass was uncomfortable as fudge, you guys. It was just so crazy. And then in the last scene of the episode, Leah visits her school counselor about withdrawing for the semester and doing online classes again. She uses Allie as an excuse, you know, all her appointments and stuff, but again, she only really gets Allie on weekends. The guy warns her that she needs to be extremely motivated and disciplined to complete online classes, which we all know Leah is anything but. He also tells her that it would be challenging for her to get through a 4-year degree in 4 years, you know, being a mother and all of that stuff, and that, you know, don't worry about it because these days people are starting to finish these degrees in like 6, 6.5 years, and this makes Leah break down crying, and she just is so embarrassed over it, and it was so endearing, you guys. She's like no one in my family has ever gone through like college or anything like that. I really want this for my girls and for my family in general. And I was like, oh my god, right there, like tearing up with her. I've always had a soft spot for Leah, and I'm so like rooting for her, even though, you guys, honestly, I don't think she's gonna complete it, at least not in her 20s or anything like that, but I do have a soft spot for her and I do hope that she does something at the very least. So that's about it for this episode of Teen Mom 2, y'all. What did you think about it? Did anything like really stand out to you? I'm kind of sitting here thinking, huh, I don't really remember anything being that notable other than that scene where Jace was doing the whole wouldn't it be funny if ice just like went through your mouth while we were driving, or how Jenelle handled Kaiser's meltdown like in the most unmotherly way possible. She acted like it was some stranger's child. I'm pretty sure your kids' teachers handle them a lot better than she handles her own damn child, you guys. So as usual, leave all of your thoughts and opinions in the comment section down below and we'll chat. You can also like this video, subscribe for more, feel free to share it with your friends as well, and follow me across social media where I absolutely love chatting with you. That's all for now. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.